hit the remote there and ended that a bit too early, but I hope you were enjoying that hit song. Here's the pub quiz question for tonight. I expect most of you know this singer. Who was the singer? Come on. Stevie Wonder. Oh, it's up there. Sorry. Oh, I knew I hit that one too early. Sorry. Yes. Very good. Okay. Stevie Wonder. You all got that one right. But that was his hit song, which spent 6 weeks in number one in the US Rhythm and Blues chart. In which year? In which year? No, later. Come on, let's get this year right. Sorry? 1980, did I hear? No, earlier than that. A little bit earlier than 72, you're pretty close, whoever that was. A little bit later, in between 68 and 72, 1970. That was Stevie Wonder, well done. That was his hit, of course, called Signed, Sealed, Delivered, I'm Yours. Well, the phrase signed, sealed, and delivered actually comes from a legal expression to literally sign, seal, and deliver a deed, a legal document promising that you're the owner of something or someone's going to promise to do something. If you had that deed and it was signed, sealed, and delivered, what it says is yours. Well, as Paul begins this letter to the Ephesians that we're learning from this term, he praises God for what he's done for the Ephesians. He praises God because God has signed, sealed, and delivered the Ephesian Christians, and they are now his. They are God's. But before we look a bit more at that, let's pray. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that we can come together this morning and celebrate what you have done for us in Jesus and what you are doing for us in Jesus. Help us to rejoice in him today and be strengthened in our faith through him. Amen. Well, as we look at these first opening verses of Paul's letter to the Ephesians, Paul has written one big, gigantic sentence from verses 3 to 14. It's one sentence in the Greek, no punctuation or anything like that. He pours out this praise, this overture of praise to God for what he's done to make us his. Now, have a look with me in your Bibles on page 1006 or on the screen. At verse 3, as Paul begins this overture of praise, he says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ." And now, with a slight play of words, as Paul opens this overture, as we go through what God has done for us, how he's given us every spiritual blessing in Christ, we're going to see, going backwards, how we are yours, how we are God's. We're in his family. That's in the outline on your sheet if you've got that there, if you want to follow. We're going to see how we've been delivered, how we have redemption. We're going to see something to do with sealing. Actually, we're going to see unsealing, that God has made known his great plan to us. And we're going to see how we are signed that we have the Holy Spirit if we belong to God. And as we explore this overture, we see that we have all this spiritual blessing in Christ. It's all about Jesus. We're not blessed and we don't have this spiritual blessing because of anything we have done, but because of what God has done for us in Jesus. So let's have a look at this blessing first of all. Firstly, how we are in God's family. I'm yours, we are in God's family. How is it that you're a child of God if you are? Well, let's see how Paul puts it in verses 4 as he writes to these Christians in Ephesus. He says, "We have every spiritual blessing in Christ," verse 3, "for God chose us in him," that is in Christ, "before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." See, we have been chosen in Christ. We weren't chosen when we were born. We weren't chosen when we'd done enough good things to outweigh our bad. We could never do that, actually. We weren't even chosen when we heard ourselves the gospel and believed it. What does Paul say in verse 4? He says that we were chosen before the creation of the world. That is just mind-blowing, isn't it? If you're a Christian, you were chosen by God before even the world was created, when there was nothing. We were chosen by Him. God's choosing is so different to ours, isn't it? Don't know how you choose what to do in different things, but it was probably that we choose the best thing, don't we? How do you choose which candidate to employ if you're interviewing some candidates for a job? Well, hopefully you choose the best candidate. How do you choose what to eat? Maybe when you're out or maybe at home, do you go for the best kind of thing that tickles your taste buds? Or the thing that's most healthy? Or maybe you go for the best value thing? What do you choose, or how do you choose your clothes to wear? Well, hopefully it's something that you look good in. All those kind of choosings are based on merit, aren't they? But God's choosing is not like ours. We do not deserve it. And in fact, it is based on His love. Have a look with me at verse 5. Paul says, "In love, He, God, predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will." See, it's in love that we have been chosen to be in God's family through Jesus. Now, what Paul is outlining here in these opening verses is what is known as the doctrine of election, or the truth of election, that God chooses those who are His. And this delights Him to do this. I know this doctrine of election can be hard for us to understand sometimes, but in one sense, I don't think it's that hard to get our heads around if we let God be God. If we let God be in control rather than seek to be in control ourselves. One Christian writer, Kent Hughes, says this about this doctrine of election. He says, "The doctrine of election is a divine revelation. It comes from God. It's not a human speculation. It is not to be set aside as the imagination of some overactive religious minds, but rather humbly accepted as revelation, however mysterious it may be, from God. We must never allow our subjective experience of choosing Christ to water down the fact that we would not have chosen Him if He had not chosen us first. We have been chosen in Christ, and God has given us His grace in Christ." Paul says in verse 6 that we've been chosen based on grace, and that grace God has freely given us in Jesus, the one He loves. And so because God has chosen us and given us grace in Christ, we can be confident. We can be confident that we are part of God's family and that we're not illegitimate children. In fact, God's family has no illegitimate children. There's no one around the table at the big family gathering who you're thinking, "Who's that? Are they in the family?" There's no accidents with who is included in God's family. Every Christian is chosen in Christ. Each and every Christian has been predestined for adoption into God's family in Christ. Each and every Christian has been freely given God's undeserved kindness, His grace to us in Christ. And so as we look around at others at church, Paul says we should praise God. And we should praise God because He's chosen the people that are sitting in front of you to be part of His family. And we must praise God because He's poured out His grace on the people sitting beside you. God's family has no illegitimate children. We're all meant to be here if God has chosen us in Christ. So what about you? Is your identity in Christ? Is it, as Paul says here, adopted into God's family as a son of the living God? Or are you finding your identity somewhere else? Finding it in work, or in family, or in friends, or in spirituality, or some other way. God says to us, you're mine if you're in his family. I've decided it. Because in Jesus, we have been delivered. That's the next thing Paul says. We have redemption. We've been delivered from our sins. Here it is in verse 7. Paul says, in him, that is in Jesus again, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he has lavished on us. God has redeemed us in Christ. That is, God has paid the price for us to be his. See, the cost is too much for us to bear because the cost, as Paul said, was the blood of Christ, God's Son. Jesus himself in Mark chapter 10, verse 45 says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and what? To give his life as a ransom for many, to pay the price that we could not pay. Because Jesus died on the cross, we have forgiveness of sins. And so that should encourage us that no sin can separate us from God's family. I wonder if you ask yourself, where is it that you're battling with sin at the moment? Where is it that you often sin? Now, we should seek to stop sinning, yes, but when we sin, find comfort that despite your sin, nothing can put you outside of God's family. If he's chosen you, you're his. All our sins, past, present, and future, have been paid for in full by the redemption that we have in the blood of Christ. And again, this is in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he has lavished on us, extravagant grace poured out. We've been delivered, we have redemption. Next, Paul talks about God's plan and the unsealing of God's great plan. God has made his great plan known to us. Have a look with me at verses 9 and 10. With all wisdom and understanding, he, God, made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times have reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. God's great plan, his plan that has always been from the beginning of time, is now revealed in Christ. And that is to unite all things in heaven and on earth under the lordship of Jesus Christ. God is going to bring everything together in Jesus. It's like Paul says to the Philippians when he writes to them in Philippians chapter 2, that Jesus is Lord, and one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. God's great plan is a cosmic plan, isn't it? Everything, including you and me, there's nothing outside the realm of Jesus' rule, is going to be brought together in Christ. And Paul goes back with this thought to election again. In verse 11, he says, in him, in Jesus, we were chosen, having been predestined according to this plan, this great cosmic plan, of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. See, nothing can stop God's great cosmic plan. God will work out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, which is to bring everything under Christ. And so let's trust in God's great plan. He's going to bring everything together under Christ. There'll be battles along the way. We won't necessarily always see that. Paul will show us some of those battles as we go through his letter. But we know the outcome. We know the final score. God wins. And God's shown that to us in his victory, in Jesus' death and resurrection. And one day, when the times have reached their fulfillment, In God's timing, when Jesus returns, Jesus' victory over Satan, sin, and death will bring heaven and earth together under the lordship of Jesus. And until then, we need to keep trusting in God's great plan. But we're not alone as we do this. For we have been signed. God has marked us out as His. We have the Holy Spirit. Now, Paul now gets very personal to the Ephesians. Up till now, he's been talking generally of all Christians, us and we. God's done this for us. He's brought us into His family. He's redeemed us. He's chosen us. But now he says this includes you, Ephesians. Verse 13. This is what Paul says. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now, the Ephesians have heard the gospel, the good news about Jesus that Paul has been explaining to them. In fact, if you read Acts chapter 19, you can get the background to the Ephesian church. And Paul has been telling them about Jesus. He's been telling them the gospel for 2 years. They've heard the good news from Paul and then from other leaders in the church as Paul has moved on elsewhere in his missionary travels. The Ephesians have heard the gospel, Paul says, but it doesn't stop there. They have believed it. And at that point of belief, when they say, yes, that's true, when they say that, yes, I recognize that I was dead without Christ and I need Him to make me alive, at that point they were marked in Christ with a seal. And God says, you're mine. And He gave them the Holy Spirit. God came to live in them. And Paul says this down payment, this deposit, is a guarantee of that future that is to come. Everything united under Christ, that wonderful inheritance. We have been marked in Christ. And I suspect somewhere at home, or maybe even on yourself today, you have something that is marked as yours. Maybe it's a sticker on a water bottle. Maybe it's a sticker on a plate or something that you've taken somewhere. Maybe it's on your phone and on your lock screen. It tells people this is your phone and how they can get in touch with you. Maybe it's one of these stickers that you get from church if you're signed in here coming regularly and you've put it on something, maybe inside your Bible. That marks it as yours, doesn't it? Those stickers that we put on things, mark them as ours. They belong to you. And that's what God has done for the Ephesians and for us. When we've heard the gospel of our salvation and believed it, God has put His sticker on us and said, she's mine, he's mine. And that sticker is His seal, the promised Holy Spirit. He says, you're mine now. You're safe until all things have been united together under Christ. I will not lose you. I will hold you fast. You are mine. We've been signed. We have the Holy Spirit. And notice as Paul becomes personal to the Ephesians, he includes two things here that involve us so that we might be God's. Now, firstly, we need to hear the gospel. But it's not enough just to hear it. We need to believe it. Now, these don't negate God's sovereignty. They don't negate His election, His choosing us before the foundation of the world, His predestining us for adoption into His family, redeeming us through the blood of Jesus. They don't negate God's sovereignty in all this. But it puts alongside it human responsibility. So let me ask you, have you heard the gospel? Well, if you've been listening in our service so far today and keep listening, and you've been listening to this sermon, you have heard the gospel. But have you believed it? Have you said, yes, I know that I'm a sinner in need of rescue, and the only rescue plan is Jesus? If you've heard the gospel and you've believed it, then we're God's. We're in his family. We have his seal upon us, the Holy Spirit. And if we're God's, well, what are we doing for other people so that they might hear the gospel? How are we gospeling others so that they too might be God's? So that they might have every spiritual blessing in Christ. Who is it that you're seeking to gospel, to share this good news of Jesus with? It's a hard thing to do, isn't it? So let me encourage you to come along to that Every Opportunity course on Tuesday nights in August, so that we might encourage one another in gospeling, so that people might hear the gospel and have the opportunity to believe, that they might be part of God's family too. As Paul begins this wonderful letter to the Ephesian church, and as we overhear it here at Mosman Village Church and keep on hearing it this term, we've seen today that we are God's. We've been signed, sealed, and delivered. We're his. We have every spiritual blessing in Christ. There's nothing that God is withholding, because he's given us his Son, and we're in him. And I don't know if you noticed as we went through, this is all to the praise of God's glory. Paul begins, doesn't he, with praise, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says that this adoption into God's family is to the praise of God's glorious grace. He comes back to this idea in verse 12, that when God has brought us into his family, we might be for the praise of his glory. And we're sealed with the Spirit to the praise of God's glory. All this is for the praise of God and the praise of his glorious grace. So let's pray now before we praise the Lord in our next song. Maybe the musicians want to come out so we're ready to praise the Lord. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have done for us in your glorious Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that in the Lord Jesus we've been signed, sealed, and delivered. We are yours as we've heard the gospel of Jesus and believed in him. Father, we thank you that you have lavished your grace upon us. You've held nothing back from us. And that you're keeping us safe, that we are yours, your Holy Spirit is in us. And your plan is to bring everything together under the Lord Jesus, including us. So we praise you for this. Amen.